time, your gateway to the world. AFR American Freedom Radio.
Give it to them.
Get real and heal. Listen to Christie on Soul Journeys Radio.
All right. Good evening, everyone, and happy Wednesday. It is September 4, 2013. Hope you all had a beautiful day. We sure have a fascinating show in store for you tonight. So thank you all very much for joining us here tonight. Soul Journeys Radio on AmericanFreedomRadio.com. If you would like to join us for the text chat tonight, that's over at Soul Journeys Radio. com, or any questions or comments, please feel free to call in tonight, 218-339-8525. That's 218-339-8525. Our special guest tonight is Guy Stephen Needler. He has a background, or was trained as a mechanical engineer, and I guess now you can kind of call him a spiritual engineer, so to speak. A really fascinating story of how that all transpired. He is an author, a healer, and just as so many things. I'll let him tell us all about it here, but we're going to talk about one or more of his books tonight, the topic, The History of God, which is the title of one of his books. You can find at his website. That's GuyStephenNeedler.com, and that's Stephen spelt with a V. That's GuyStephenNeedler.com. And he has authored The History of God, Beyond the Source, Book 1, Book 2, The Origin Speaks, Avoiding Karma and Cosmos. He has so much going on here. And also, he's in the UK, by the way, for our UK listeners. He does lectures all over the world, literally, and local workshops and such as well. So check it out. That's Guy Stephen with a V, Needler.com. But it is so good to have you here tonight, Guy. How are you doing?
I'm doing fine, thank you. It's great to be on the show, and it's great to be broadcast through American Freedom Radio. Thank you very much for inviting me.
Oh, I could not pass up the opportunity. Guy is another fine gentleman I met at the Transformation Conference in July in Arkansas. I got to see him speak about his work on this book, and I'm just like, oh my gosh, he's so awesome. Plus, Sherry Cortland, we all know and love her, introduced me to you, so we knew you had to be good if Sherry spoke that highly of you.
Yeah, Sherry's a great person, great author, and a great advocate for the spiritual world. We met Sherry the first time, my wife and I met Sherry the first time we went to the Transformation Conference in 2011, and we hit it off straight away. We have the same thought processes, we have the same ideals, and we have the same ways of thinking about the spiritual existence, as it were, but we have different ways of presenting it to the general public, the spiritual general public, which is ideal, because although we link up quite nicely together, Sherry's got her way of doing it and I've got another way of doing it, because out there we're not all the same. We're different people, we learn in different ways, and everybody has a different way of understanding and assimilating the information. So everybody, all these authors out there that are part of the spiritual world through the Ozark Mountain Publishing House, and of course other publishing houses out there who are working for spirit, everybody's got a way into affecting people out there who are interested, because not everybody's the same.
I so agree with that. My opinion is the more the merrier. We all, you know, operate at different frequencies, and you know, we can relate better to, you know, different people than maybe our neighbor or something. I know I certainly drive many people nuts. I can't stand to hear anything I have to say, but, you know, Guy or somebody else, they're like, hey, you know what? That resonates with me. That works. So exciting times with all, you know, so many people coming forward like yourself and talking about this information. And what I appreciate the most about you and Sherry and others like you is that You're not standing from an authoritative position. You're not like, oh, well, I'm so cool, only I can do this, and I'm so special, you know? You are empowering us and teaching us that we can also do these things ourselves. So thank you for that, Guy.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, the most important thing is to realize that everybody can do what we're doing. It's just that some people decide to do it and some people decide not to do it. Some people are in the public eye and some people aren't in the public eye. Mm-hmm. And there's no rules as to how you do it. It's all helping everybody, whether it's just chatting to somebody in the canteen at work or whether it's being a megastar on TV presenting it in an evangelical way. Yeah, the whole thing is that everybody has a niche to follow and everybody has a way of presenting it. And because somebody attracts thousands doesn't mean they're better than somebody who attracts one or two. Everybody's got the role to play and everybody's got their way of doing it. And it really is a very humbling thing to note that when we're given this opportunity to do it, we're being given the opportunity to do it in our way, then, you know, we have to think to ourselves, wow, what an opportunity we've got. What a real opportunity we've got to be able to do what we want to do with the information we're getting from spirit and presenting it in a way which we are good at doing, but nevertheless recognizing that that's not for everybody. Some certain people have different ways of understanding things and learning things. And so somebody who's good at understanding, for instance, Sherry's stuff would not be able to work with my stuff or even Dolores Cannon's stuff, you know. This is why there's so many teachers out there. Everybody has their own method of learning, and so there needs to be different teachers out there to do it. And that's why we had people like Jesus, Buddha, Muhammad, you know, and all those different individuals out there. Babaji, for instance, you know, even quite recently, Paramahansa Yogananda. Every one of these masters has had an ability to teach something in a slightly different way to cope with the genre of individual that's available right now, and their ability to assimilate the knowledge.
Definitely. I agree with and appreciate that very much. And it's also kind of, you know, because that's what this is about. Everybody's spiritual journey or awakening or whatever, or evolution, is an individual and unique process. So I think it's so beautiful that, you know, people like yourself and all these different, you know, personalities and methods, modalities, etc., are out there, because, you know, we're coming from a paradigm where we're taught, oh, it's only this way. You have to do it exactly that way. You know, like the hokey pokey. You have to put your right arm up first, then your left arm, then your right leg. And you know, it really isn't that. It doesn't have to be that rigid. So, yeah, just I think it's wonderful to encourage people to, you know, find their own way. Listen to all of it. Take with it what you like. You know, throw away or even file away what doesn't resonate with you at this time. But, yeah, there definitely is more than one spiritual path or way to God, right?
Well, as the Romans said, all roads lead to Rome. It's just a matter of recognizing which is your road, really. And that's the most important thing. Yeah. Every one of us who has the opportunity of being a teacher in some way have a really important role, but a very humbling role, to be in a position where we can provide information, where we can help individuals move forwards. And right now, you know, things are completely different than they used to be back in the 1940s and 1950s. The frequencies are so much higher than they used to be. And so, therefore, things that would take an individual, or let's say 150 years ago, 30 or 40 years of dedicated renunciant-based training to get to a certain level of understanding and ability to contact that which is part of the greater reality, that which is part of spirit, it simply isn't necessary these days. As you've said, you know, we used to be able to, you know, do things in a certain rigid way. That's not strictly true right now. We've got the ability to, with the right level of training, circumnavigate, you know, years of training in the space of days. It's amazing what we can do now.
Yeah, definitely. And, you know, speaking of paths, I am particularly interested in those of us that come out of the very rigid, structured, mechanical engineer type professions. How does that happen? How does one go from being a mechanical engineer to talking to God or writing books on the history of God? Can you share with us a little bit about your path and your awakening that led you down this spiritual path?
Yeah, well, actually, it's a bit more than mechanical engineering, because I jumped ship to being electrical and electronics engineer, which is even more rigid.
Oh, wow.
that was fairly early on in my career. Well, in effect, Christy, I was involved in spiritualism from a very, very young age, as I now know. From about the age of about four, actually, I started to notice different things happening around me. Seeing different things, understanding different things, getting cosmic knowledge, working with stuff that was out there that was not particularly being taught by the standard education process that we go through in kindergarten school, what we call junior school in the UK, then senior school later. But I noticed that I was understanding things and working with things in my early teens and pre-teens as well. And I got to the point where I was doing lots of meditation to understand what was happening around me. And I noticed there were certain books that were very good and very influential to me. But around my late teens, I was doing one of my morning meditations, and I had a visitation by four robed individuals, white robed individuals, doing this meditation. I mean, previously, done lots of experiments in trying to bring things back from different physical levels, different frequential levels, and failing, of course, because the different frequencies don't work in this particular level because it's too low. And I was advised that what I was doing was right, what I was researching was right, but it was a long time for me. I needed to get some more earthly grounding, which I now recognize was not specifically for me, but for my breadth and knowledge and depth of information that I could use as a communication medium between spirit and myself, and therefore as a vehicle for describing what I was picking up in my communications with the source and other entities and the origin later in my life. But from the point of getting that information about from those four guides, which I now recognise aren't my guides, they're my peer group, they said to me, it's not the right time. From that point in time, I literally, very subliminally, switched off from spiritual work. I, although had one eye open on it, like a sleeping cat, as it were, I was interested in it. I never had the same amount of almost aggressive interest in pursuing different things. And so over the next number of years, I did what everybody else does in the material world. I became more materialistic. I wanted to accelerate my career progression with the business that I was in. I became middle management. I met my wonderful wife, Anne, who was very supportive of what I was doing, very spiritual in her own right. And we bought a house, worked with the house, and we progressed in all sorts of different ways. And then towards the end of my 40s, after I'd pretty much finished one of my master's degrees, I was advised by a friend of mine, who's now my business manager, Jane. She's a great girl, and she's doing all the things that I don't like doing. She's organizing me and doing all of the processes and procedures surrounding some of the work I'm doing in terms of correspondence courses, etc. And of course, organised the workshops. I went to, was advised she was going to go to a Reiki share and where I wanted to come. Initially, I refused, saying, no, I'm not particularly interested. But after about two or three invites, I said, oh, okay, I'll go. A year later, I popped out to the size of Reiki Master because I was hooked almost.
Wow.
Right away. Yeah, that fast. And during the same sort of time, I went into another master's degree, not specifically for business administration, but this instance was for a master's degree in science, imaging technology, which is still fast-moving stuff. But I was having a hard time with the maths because there was maths involved that just wasn't there when I was at school. It's completely new maths, so I had to learn how to work with it and also work with different assignments within the university I was working with, which was specifically stressful, I have to say. So I went to an energy healer who I was advised to go to by my father-in-law, who was also very spiritual and interested in metaphysics.
Okay.
And she said, well, you know, you're doing okay. I was recovering quite nicely and starting to work with the work and then moving forwards. And she said, in one session, I'm going to do a workshop, but I'm doing an introduction first over a weekend. And it's based upon all the work that she'd done by her teacher, who was Barbara Brennan. Some of you might know Barbara Brennan. She wrote The Hands of Light and Light Emerging books. And she's been quite an influential individual within the American energy healing scene. And she's also part of a couple of groups of people, one of them being Donovan and Susan Thesenga, who did the Pathwork series, and John and Eva Pierrakos, who are also very influential within the medical scene. John Pierrakos, being a medical doctor in New York, managed to find a way of seeing the human aura, initially with filters in front of the human eye, but later didn't need to do it. So they were groundbreaking individuals. And Barbara Brennan herself was a NASA scientist. This intrigued me. So I went to this introduction weekend with Helen, my teacher, who was a first generation.
It's time to get real and heal. MyTrueEssence.net would like to tell you about Modifolan Brown Seaweed Extract. It's composed of an elementally rich seaweed called laminaria. It takes 40 pounds of laminaria to make just 1 pound of Modifolan. There's nothing else like Modifolan. It is the richest in alginate, phocoidin, organic iodine, and lamarian. Alginates are the most effective organic element in nature that enable the body to rid itself of heavy metals, radioactive elements, and toxins. Phocoidin is an extremely effective anti-cancer substance found abundantly in brown seaweed. Organic iodine is the greatest protection for the thyroid offered by nature. Laminarin aids in the prevention and treatment of cardiovascular disease. Go to www.mytrueessence.net and click the Modifolan banner to get started on your path to rich health today. Also check out the Healing Shop for proven essential oils, medicinal teas, and even health coaching. It's time to get real and heal. Go to www.mytrueessence.net.
Get real and heal. Listen to Christie on Soul Journeys Radio.
No rules. No rules. No taboo topics. No taboo topics. No fear of doom. No fear of doom. We are American Freedom Radio. American Freedom Radio.
Welcome back and thanks for joining us here tonight. Soul Journeys Radio on AmericanFreedomRadio.com. We are going to be discussing the history of God with our special guest tonight, Guy Needler. His website is GuyStephenNeedler.com. And Guy, you were sharing with us before we went to break your journey from a mechanical and electronics engineer and becoming a Reiki master and everything that led you to where you are today. So please continue.
Yes, it's quite impressive being by the adverts. It's even more impressive remembering where you were. Where were we? Yes, basically what happened was I was being trained by a first generation student of Barbara Brennan, who was a very influential healer within the US and very groundbreaking healer, I have to say. And so I went to a weekend that was introducing a workshop that this lady Helen Stott was introducing as being the almost exactly the same teaching that she'd received from Helen, from Barbara, and would I be interested? So I said, yes, okay, I'll go along. After that weekend, I signed up to a 4-year commitment and a large financial commitment as well to do it. And during this time, I was taught all of the different aspects of energy healing from a completely scientific perspective. Now, while this was going on, a friend of mine who used to work with me in the automotive industry moved to Sweden, and he had established himself in a place called Trollhättan, not far from Gothenburg. And he was also a Reiki master. And another Reiki friend of his said that you've got to go over there because there's something important going to happen. So he invited myself and my wife, Anne, over to Trollhättan for a long weekend, 5 days stay. You know, we'd go over there, stay with him, and we'd take a cheap flight. Well, at that point in time, there were some really cheap flights going on. There was a price war flight-wise going on in the UK. And so we got return flights for about £19.50 each.
Oh, wow.
From the UK to Gothenburg, which is remarkable. So we managed that. We went away and we saw our friend. And the second day we were there, he said, oh, we're going to go for a walk, nice riverside walk, and we'll walk from my house towards the Trollhättan village or town centre. And we said, okay, we'll do it. But whilst we were walking down this path, which, I mean, his house went very, very quickly across into the sort of forest area. It's led down to this forest walk, and then this forest walk went into a riverside walk. And you followed the river up towards Trollhättan, which is this nice little small village throughout town. As I was doing this, actually my hands started to tingle, and then my arms started to tingle, and then my whole body started to tingle. And I said to Graham, I said, this is amazing. I'm really picking some energy up here. And I need to stop and meditate. So I've got a strong feeling to meditate. And we just passed this rock, which was a little minor island just off this riverside walk. You know, a small jump of about 1 meter isolated it from the walk site. So I said, Graham, I've got to stop here and meditate on this rock, on this very rock. Mm. He said, okay. Myself and Anne, my wife, would walk up towards this suspension bridge, which is about a quarter of a mile walk up the road, up this path. So they did that, and I sat down meditating. Within that meditation, which was 20 to 25 minutes, I received what I can understand as being the most profound attunement or download I've ever experienced in my whole life. My voice and my speech was affected so much, and my processes were affected so much that I couldn't string three words together. It was like being drunk, but without being drunk. I just couldn't control myself vocally. It was difficult. And Graham and Anne came back from this suspension bridge they were on, and they positioned themselves in the middle of this suspension bridge. And they said they actually picked up what they called alien craft coming through a portal, and they were hovering around me, and that... They were rewiring me. But before they actually said that, on their journey down, I'd come out of this attunement, so I was looking around myself, looking around the area. And bearing in mind there was at this point in time, there was it was complete dead calm. There was no wind at all. When I looked across this river, there was an area of complete choppy water, like almost like the sort of water you'd expect from a helicopter's downwash. And as I looked and concentrated more, I started to pick out the outline of some really strange craft. And when I started to pick these out, I got this massive, overwhelming voice come through my mind's ear, if you want to call it that, saying, "Don't strain it; you'll upset what we've done." So just back off of this and leave it alone. Yeah.
Yeah.
And it was amazing because, you know, I was seeing these things. It was almost like seeing a Klingon, you know, you see Star Trek, you see a Klingon spacecraft, you see the outline.
Yeah.
And everything else, the sort of background. It was just like that. But
amazing.
But a little bit more intricate, you know. It's completely, the shape was completely unlike what you'd ever expect to see. And from that point onwards, I was affected profoundly. I went back to doing my... Yeah, I went back to do my training with my energy healing teacher, and I started to do things that I couldn't do before, like go to different levels that weren't being taught. And I was told off significantly. I was really quite significantly reprimanded for going to levels that I wasn't being taught and weren't particularly there, apparently.
Yeah, okay.
And, you know, some of the trainees I was with were being disturbed by some of the imagery they were getting and what they were experiencing. So yeah. I had to behave myself within the classes. But I resolved to try to understand and mediate within myself a process that would allow me to go to these different levels and create a metric that would allow me to do that. And whilst I was doing this, I established I could get to certain levels, made contact with certain entities and individuals, and eventually made contact with an entity that ends up being quite a large entity, that eventually announced itself as our source, our God. And then much later, a much, much larger entity announced itself as being that which created our source, the origin. And it's the meditations I used to have in the morning with my wife before we went to work. We used to sort of go and stand there by a tree in a quite large garden, separate trees, by the way, and meditate for about 15 minutes. I was picking up information, and I'd relay this information to my wife as I drove her to the train station. And she said, you've got to write this down. So I started to write it down at lunchtime at work. And what happened was, so I started to write it down and started to journal everything I was picking up. Yeah. And at a certain point, probably about in 2005, I started to realize that, hang about, I've got enough information here to start to write a book on.
Yeah.
Because looking around at other books that were around there on sort of similar genres and that sort of stuff, I thought, well, this information is different, it's unique. I could create this into a book. So I kept going, I kept journaling the information, kept trying to go higher in the frequencies and succeeding to go to different levels. And the journaled information eventually came out as the History of God, which I subsequently sent out to numerous different publishing houses. And it was around about I think it was actually New Year's Eve of the Christmas of 2009 that I received an email from Julia Cannon, Dolores Cannon's daughter, that they were interested in publishing the material. And since then, I've been continuing to journal information from the source and going beyond our source to its peers and the origin itself. And that's what's created the History of God, and then Beyond the Source Book 1 and Beyond the Source Book 2 and The Avoiding Karma Book, which has just been accepted and I've signed the contract for, and The Origin Speaks, which I am now 90,000 words into.
Wow. Now, Guy, what was the length of time that you just described to us in your path, like when you started journaling till it turned into The History of God, your book?
Well, from the start of picking up stuff to the start of finishing the last sentence was about 7 years, can you believe?
Okay.
But the second book, second book was 18 months, and the third book was 12 months.
Wow. Okay.
And Avoiding Karma was 9 months. But this book I'm working on now has already been 12 months.
Okay. Wow.
I've not finished it yet. This is going to be a significant book. And it's hard work as well.
Yeah, of course. Now, did it seem that the more you were doing it, getting into those states or meditating on those rocks and such, the information just came to you faster? I mean, did you know that there was a book or multiple books in the future? Or was it just kind of like, whoa, why are you talking to me? Or what's going on here?
Yeah, well, it's interesting that because throughout my life, I've known I've got something important to do. And I can remember being about 8 or 9 when there's an English actor called Robert Powell, was the lead role in the Jesus of Nazareth TV series. And I thought, and I just knew I was there. I could have been there or doing that sort of stuff. And I just knew that my role was to do something important. So when I was doing this stuff and started to kick off, I thought, this is it. This is what I'm supposed to be doing. I'd had previous false starts in moving forwards, but now I know they weren't false starts. They were just part of the whole package. Because I started to do the healing on my own in about 2005, and it lasted about 6 or 7 months. And then the clientele petered out. Of course, I was linked into a healing center in a place in Birmingham, not far from where I live. But now I do it worldwide, and I mix it with readings, and I mix it with other bits and pieces as well, the workshops. And via Skype. So it wasn't a case of it was the wrong thing to do. It was a case of the timing wasn't there at the time to do what I was doing and mixing it in with everything else. And, you know, it was amazing that I had this precognition of what was going to happen to me, and I needed to be in a certain financial state to do it. And it's all happened. Everything that I've preconceived previously has happened and is happening in front of my very eyes right now. And so I'm in total awe and in total humility that I've been given the opportunity to do what I'm doing, and that which I've preconceived is actually coming into place as well. It's fantastic.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, let me ask you that. God, there's so many questions. So you know what? We'll just start with the latest one on the text chat. They're asking if you, I mean, throughout all of your research and your experiences and your books, what is your definition of God?
Everything.
There you go.
Yeah. Well, discounting the other bit, which is that which created our God, our source. Our source is a vast tract of energy that's got its own sentience and was created as a result of a desire from its creator to understand itself in a greater detail. It's been given a reason to be and a purpose in existence. And a caveat that it can experience anything it wants to and do anything it wants to do in any way it wants to do it, as long as experience learns and evolves. And mm-hmm. and in that context, our particular source entity created a multiverse. It separated itself out into two. One bit is itself. Mm. Another bit is an environment for evolutionary progression. And within that environment, it placed myriad, countless billions of smaller versions of itself, which aren't separate, but they are individualized units mm-hmm. of itself, to experience the minute detail of that which is available through this multiversal structure. So what is God? God is everything. We are God. The table is God. The walls of our house are God. You know, the blades of grass in our garden are God. The chimes on this clock, which you can hear in the background, oh God, you know. But we are all part of a larger entity that has been created to experience, learn, and evolve in any way possible. And that's our remit as well, is to go and do it. But the thing is, what we're being allowed to do now is to experience it in its lowest frequencies possible. And the only way we can do that is to experience it in a holistic way, by having a vehicle to do it in, and that is the human body. And so, and so everything that we're doing is to experience, learn, and evolve. But even these transient human bodies are part of God. They're part of the source entity. It's all created from the same material. It's all created from the same energies that are available within the multiverse.
Huh. Could it be fair to say that God is energy, maybe?
Yes, myriad different types of energy.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, in one of the books, I think it was Beyond the Source book two, I was given information about sacred geometry and how sacred geometry.
It's time to get real and heal. MyTrueEssence.net would like to tell you about Modifiland Brown Seaweed Extract. It's composed of an elementally rich seaweed called laminaria. It takes 40 pounds of laminaria to make just 1 pound of Modifiland. There's nothing else like Modifiland. It is the richest in alginate, phocoidin, organic iodine, and lemurian. Alginates are the most effective organic element in nature that enable the body to rid itself of heavy metals, radioactive elements, and toxins. Phocoidin is an extremely effective anti-cancer substance found abundantly in brown seaweed. Organic iodine is the greatest protection for the thyroid offered by nature. Laminarin aids in the prevention and treatment of cardiovascular disease. Go to www.mytrueessence.net and click the Modifiland banner to get started on your path to rich health today. Also check out the Healing Shop for proven essential oils, medicinal teas, and even health coaching. It's time to get real and heal. Go to www.mytrueessence.net.
Get real and heal. Listen to Christy on Soul Journeys Radio.
Yo, what's up? Check this out.
The the voice of the revolution. American Freedom Radio. American Freedom Radio.
And thanks for joining us here tonight with Guy Stephen Needler on Soul Journeys Radio. The history of God is the topic, and woohoo! Lots of questions already. Guy, you left off. You were kind of giving us your definition and some of the messages that came to you. So you started to tell us about when they introduced you to sacred geometry.
Yeah, well, sacred geometry, I was advised, was to do with the almost the description of energy in terms of what it was as an energy, what it could work with, what it would create, what it was influenced by, what it could interface with, and whole genre of other bits and pieces that was to do with it. And there was not just one specific type of sacred geometry. There was like up to 12 different dimensional types of sacred geometry. And these are dimensions that are well beyond what we think dimensions are. So it was quite amazing that I was being given this information about it and being able to describe energies in a very high-level sense by the use of what certain levels of geometry are being used. So when we talk about sacred geometry, you know, it's not just about what it looks like and everything else.
It's not just beautiful.
Yeah, a whole program behind it of what it does for us, which is immense. And of course, all of these things, not specifically in terms of the energies and how they're described by these different sacred geometries, are specific to our own source entity, our own God. They are consistent throughout the energies that are being used for the other source entities, the other co-creators, if you want to call them that. That were created by the origin to allow it to understand itself in a more accelerated way.
Oh, absolutely. Let me ask you this. A couple questions in the chat, Guy, in reference to God and the energy. He asks, but who created the energy of God? In college science, they teach us that energy is neither created nor lost. So how the heck did it evolve anyways?
Right. Well, first of all, before I even start that, I'm going to very, very quickly thank very much all of your listeners who have sent questions in or just listening to this show. It's humbling to have these people listening in to want to know more about the greater reality. I am humbled that I'm able to give information when I can do. And it's great that you guys are out there, guys and gals, who are out there to understand this stuff. But let's get into it. So thank you very much for tuning in. And thank you, Christian, for being a medium for doing this as well. And of course, American Freedom Radio.
Thank you.
In terms of that question, yes, a very good question. If I go back to the origin, and this is all new stuff to me because it was picked up as a result of channeling the information from the origin. Effectively, the energy was there. It's just a massive, vast tract of energy which was there that through various different chances, if you want to call it that, became various different levels of intelligence, of self-awareness, and then became sentient self-awareness and then omnipotent or omnipresent or polyomnipresent levels of self-awareness specifically for the origin. But the energies that we use to create the source entities are simply those energies that are the origin hived off and given purpose, although they've been given purpose through their own ability to become self-aware in their own right. So the origin is this thing which is a level of, shall I say, sentient, polyomniscient self-awareness that's just by luck, and I'm going to be quite honest here with what I've picked up, by luck has become self-aware and is starting to investigate itself and understand itself and wanted to accelerate that level of understanding and the speed at which it got that understanding because it recognizes that what it understands about itself is a minute fraction of 1%. she's massively small in comparison to what it really is. It recognizes that there's a vast tract of itself out there, a bit like we understand there's a universe out there, but we understand a bit about our home and our back garden, so to speak. But it knows there's something else out there, but it doesn't know the detail. So it created these other entities to accelerate its own expansion of self-awareness. And he said, well, okay. I'm going to create these things in the same sort of genre that I was created in allowing themselves to become self-aware in their own right. But when they became self-aware, it educated them. And it educated them because in a previous experiment, it didn't give that opportunity. And those entities that it created failed to become self-aware. So in giving these source entities, as it called them, which are lower, well, not so much lower entities, but subservient entities to itself, a purpose and a reason to be and a goal in existence, they started to create that which they needed to create to address that requirement of them. But there's no rules. They can do it in whichever way they wanted to. So the energies, getting back to the first question, the energies were always there. It's just that some of the energies became self-aware and grouped together to become a much bigger entity. But that entity itself is still growing. It's still expanding. You know, how can I explain it? It's difficult.
Yeah. Yeah.
Imagine, listeners, imagine that the whole Earth is one sheet of blotting paper and that somebody somewhere drops a blob of ink on this blotting paper and then that starts to spread very slowly as it's absorbed by the blotting paper. That's what the intelligence is, the sentience is, that's the origin. And then a part of that is that which is created by the origin to accelerate its own evolutionary condition, its own sense of purpose, its own understanding of self. And those, one of those are our source entity.
Okay. All right. So, more questions, of course. Source entity. So as far as us all being pieces of God and jumping into these vehicles or vessels we call the human body, would this kind of be like a practical application of our conscious creation or self-actualization of God? I mean, I don't know. I don't even really know what I'm trying to say. But, you know, when we're on the other side, we can just kind of think it and stuff happens. But in the physical body, we have to actually mechanically do it, touch it to bring it into actualization or creation.
Well, yeah. The thing is that our true energetic selves, you can call it the oversoul if you want to, you can call it the higher self if you want to, you can call it the Godhead if you want to, exists in a completely different frequential set, a different dimension.
Yes.
But in our own creation, we have the same reason to be as our creator, our source, our God, and that is to experience, learn, evolve, whatever we can do.
So our higher self might remember that we do have these creative abilities, but in our physical body, which we feel sometimes we're disconnected, that's where we actually get to physically do it.
Yeah. The thing is, the human vehicle was created to allow us to experience the lowest frequencies available within the multiverse.
Because as an
energetic entity, we can't experience fully the lower frequencies.
Yes. Yeah.
We're a higher frequency. It's a bit like a gas trying to experience ice. It can't do it. The only way ice can experience ice is by being ice.
Yes. Okay. Yeah, because water, I mean, ice is water, but water doesn't really know how ice feels until it's actually frozen.
Yeah. And okay. You know, and water is air. And water is air. Water is a gas. It's given more it's given heat or energy to create a higher frequency. And so you've got a condition there where the same material, if you want to call it that, that has a different frequency is either air, water, or ice, depending upon its frequential state, its level of energy. And so we, in our infinite wisdom, decided that we wanted to experience the lowest frequencies available within the multiverse. And the only way we could do that in some sort of purposeful way was to invent, was to create a vehicle. And that vehicle is what we now recognize as the human body. Although this is the current human body is one of a number of different variations that have evolved over the millennia to cope with the different frequential states we've
experienced. It's time to get real and heal. MyTrueEssence.net would like to tell you about Modifolan Brown Seaweed Extract. It's composed of an elementally rich seaweed called laminaria. It takes 40 pounds of laminaria to make just 1 pound of Modifolan. There's nothing else like Modifolan. It is the richest in alginate, phacoidin, organic iodine, and lemurian. Alginates are the most effective organic element in nature that enable the body to rid itself of heavy metals, radioactive elements, and toxins. Phacoidin is an extremely effective anti-cancer substance found abundantly in brown seaweed. Organic iodine is the greatest protection for the thyroid offered by nature. Laminarin aids in the prevention and treatment of cardiovascular disease. Go to www.mytrueessence.net and click the Modifolan banner to get started on your path to rich health today. Also check out the Healing Shop for proven essential oils, medicinal teas, and even health coaching. It's time to get real and heal. Go to www.mytrueessence.net.
Get real and heal. Listen to Christie on Soul Journeys Radio.
No rules. No rules. No taboo topics. No taboo topics. No fear of doom. No fear of doom. We are American Freedom Radio. American Freedom Radio.
We are here with our special guest, Guy Stephen Needler, and that is the name of his website, GuyStephenNeedler.com, and that's Stephen with a V, GuyStephenNeedler.com. There you can find out about some of his workshops and events, his readings and healings, and his books, The History of God, Beyond the Source, Book 1 and 2, The Origin Speaks, and all of the fun stuff he's working on right now. And, wow, Guy, I better give out the phone number because there's lots of questions in the chat. And, of course, it is better to call in to get your questions answered. The number is 218-339-8525. That's 218-339-8525, and to join our happy little soul family in the text chat, that's over at souljourneysradio.com. And guys, seriously, you are giving a really good description on this vast and difficult topic. It's one of those, you know, we just want to explain away every little thing there is and understand it. And I don't know if we can actually comprehend it all at this point in time. It's one of those things where, you know, we have to just kind of drop out of our head and into our heart and feel it and let the answers come, as you have done so successfully, Guy. And I guess as a result of that, you're able to explain it to us in our simple minds a little bit better. So thank you for that. Let me ask you this, a couple more questions on the chat. They're asking, what role is God supposed to play in our lives? And what role are we supposed to play in God's life?
Well, great minds think alike there. So I was just looking through some of the chats some of the guys have put in there. And, first of all, I'd like to reiterate what Conda says, can Mr. Needler please define a definition of God? Well, God is everything. We are part of God. We're individualized units of God. We are there to understand and work with the minute detail of that which it is. Mm. So we're able to zoom into those aspects of, the surface of our skin that we can't see with our eyes, but we can see with electron microscope, for instance. So we're the electron microscope aspect of God looking at its own skin on its own forearm. Mm. Psychogeometry is a way of describing and understanding the signatures and the functionality and the interaction of different energies within that which is God. God is created our God, our source entity, is created by a larger entity called the Origin, which is, I've recently discovered, consistent with something called the Absolute, which the Hindu texts speak of. Who created the energy of God? It was always there. Keith Wan said this, energy is neither created nor lost. Correct. It is never created or lost. How did it evolve? By luck. The origin evolved by complete luck. And it explains that to me in various different ways in the Origin Speaks, which I've been working with. It's one of those things where things happen, you know. It may not, and that's how the way I can describe it. It's just one of these things where energies got together and in islands of self-awareness to create a larger self-awareness. They lost their individuality to create a bigger level of individuality and sentience. What are we supposed to play in God's life? We are there to understand the minute detail of that which it can't focus on itself. We are smaller individualized units of itself. This is Anon who asked this question. And therefore, we can experience smaller aspects of that which it is, which is ultimately part of the functionality and the energy associated with the origin. But it can't do itself. It's a bit like trying to zoom into, an object that's 1 foot away from you when you're only looking through a telescope. Yeah, you need a microscope to do this, not a telescope. If God's a telescope, then we're the microscope. What is God supposed to play in our lives? God is our creator, full stop. And our role is to investigate that which God can't do itself, or would take a long time to do, and therefore he's asking us to do it for it.
Okay. All right. So then I guess the next one somebody was asking, do your friends and family understand your high-minded ways?
No.
Okay, but nobody's burned you yet, so you're fitting it well.
My family just do not understand me at all. to be honest, thank you, Jaria, for asking this question, because all through my life I've been totally misunderstood. My schoolmates didn't understand the word I was saying, although some of them did latch on, because at that time of my life, Eric Van Daniken was becoming the latest thing on the scene, and we sort of managed to get together based upon that as a medium. But really, they didn't quite understand what I was picking up. And to be honest, at that point, I didn't understand that what I was doing was having a function of clairsentience.
Yeah.
I had no idea what I was doing in those days. So, you know, I didn't get a clue at all. But, you know, my family, my father now, he says, you're well beyond me, so I haven't got a clue what you're doing. All I know is that you're very intelligent already. That's it, right? Okay.
Well, you still manage to have a wife and all of those things, so you must be doing pretty good. All right. The next question, Guy, from our chat is, is all of existence really the opposite? Is what we have now the definition of nothing and the unlimited possibility within? Maybe God is the one comprehending and dismantling that nothing into its unlimited ingredients. Wow.
Wow. I can actually see this on my own.
Obviously, obviously another high-minded individual asking that.
Well, actually, our existence, if I bring it back a level, is basically an existence that's given function, and that function is to experience, learn, and evolve. And so, what we have to do is to embrace that in every function that we embark upon, whether it's energetic or incarnate. And so, although we feel that we are limited in our incarnate state, actually we are unlimited in our energetic state. And that's why sometimes some of us incarnate feeling we can do certain things that we can't actually do whilst in the incarnate state. Things like telekinesis, teleportation, telepathy and stuff like that. While we are doing this, whichever we are doing, What, however, we're doing is that which we're experiencing, learning, and evolving from is automatically passed on to God, our source entity. That's part of the functionality of it. Now, we don't lose this evolutionary content or this learning, but it's passed on automatically. And then it's automatically passed on to its creator, the origin. And again, our source doesn't lose it because it's free information. In fact, all the other source entities also take on board all of the information from the other source entities as they're gathering it and collating it and understanding holistically what's happening in all of their other different environments or different structures that they've created, or not, as the case may be. So everything, the origin, the other source entities, and ourselves experience things concurrently, although what we experience, although shared with our source entity, is specific to our source entity. But our source entity shares that with the other source entities and the origin. So is God? So maybe God is the one comprehending and dismantling that nothing into its... Our source entity could uncreate the multiverse tomorrow, or even now, should it decide to do so. Right now, it's doing a good job, so it's leaving it alone.
Sounds good to me.
Yeah, I asked this question, and it's a basic human question. Is that which we are going to disappear at some time because it's not working? It's working beyond its wildest expectations, and that's the information that I've got. So whatever we're doing right, irrespective of how bad we think it is. Everything that is experience. Everything that we're experiencing is a level of learning. Everything that we're learning is a level of gaining evolutionary content, irrespective of whether we're part of massive scientific understanding or the deepest depths of war. Everything that we're doing is learning through experience and subsequently evolving. There is no rules how we do it. Everything is okay. The problem is we need to accept that. We need to accept that those who are world leaders are experiencing what those who are committing atrocities are experiencing. You know, everything is part of the yin and the yang of that which is there. And duality is a function of the physical universe because everything else is the various shades of grey or colour in between it. It's just that where we are right now is a very dualistic condition.
Okay. All right. That's. I'd like to talk about some of the chapters that you wrote about in your book, The History of God, which you can find at GuyStephenNeedler.com, and that's Stephen with a V. And in part two, chapter four, you talk about the history of God and meeting the origin. So let's talk about the origin. Who or what is the origin?
Well, the origin is where it all starts.
This is where our head starts sitting now, right?
The origin is a the origin is a completely indescribably large, vast tract of energy, which is everything. Everything that there can possibly be is the origin. And that includes source entities and ourselves, because the origin created the source entities and the source entities created ourselves, or our particular source entity did. But our origin, through the luck of various energies being in the right place at the right time, created various different islands of intelligent, self-aware energies, which at some point recognize that they could become something bigger should they link together and work together and give up their individuality in lieu of becoming something bigger. And that is still ongoing right now. In effect, the origin is a small part of a sentient, omnipresent self-awareness of intelligent energy that is a mere pinpoint within a vast tract of energy which is infinitesimally large that we can't possibly, and it itself doesn't understand how big that is. But it knows that some part of itself it's working with can be worked with and can be used to create things to allow itself to understand that which it is in its limited sense.
Wow. Yeah.
In its quest to understand itself better, it wanted to accelerate that. And so it created 12 origins first, and it placed them outside of its sphere of self-awareness, its area of self-awareness, that area, a bit like our back garden, where we think we understand our back garden, what grows there, what animals live there, what insects live there.
Yeah.
But beyond that, into the suburbs or the greater areas of the city that we exist within, it doesn't know what's going on. So he put these things that it created beyond those boundaries and gave them the same opportunities for becoming self-aware that it had. But that fails because, for various different reasons, it didn't work, and I've gained information about that in the Origin Speaks earlier this year. But in essence, the common denominator was the origin cannot create the origin. All that is, the absolute cannot create.
Uh-oh. Let's see. Guy, are you there? Or maybe... Okay. Something happened here. Let me see. Hopefully y'all can hear me. Not really sure. I'm hearing something.
Okay. You still there?
Oh, great. All right. Okay. Yes. Okay. Yeah. We're back.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. Okay. So we're talking about how the origin created its 12 origins, and then it reused that energy to create 12 source entities, which were 12 lesser beings that had been given a purpose, a reason to be. And within that purpose and the reason to be, these entities had a rule. And that rule was just go and do it.
Like Nike, right? Just do it.
Yeah, just do it. Just go out there and do it. How you do it is up to you. There are no rules and regulations. Just experience, learn, and evolve. Create what you need to experience that and gain the information and feedback. And that's it. Simple as that. But in terms of, you know, the origin, what it is, it's just, you know, it's so unimaginably large, it doesn't even understand itself.
Okay, well, that makes sense. Okay, you know what? When we were in Arkansas through the Transformation Conference, you and Dolores and Julia at the end of the conference were speaking about, oh, wow, all tons of interesting stuff. But I took some notes here. What was really fascinating, I thought would be wonderful to talk about here tonight, is what you referred to, I believe, the backdrop people.
Well, Dolores called them backdrop people, and I discovered something else called backfill people, and they're completely different things.
Oh, okay. You called them backfield people?
Backfill people.
Okay.
As in, if you dig a hole.
It's time to get real and heal. MyTrueEssence.net would like to tell you about Modifolan Brown Seaweed Extract. It's composed of an elementally rich seaweed called laminaria. It takes 40 pounds of laminaria to make just 1 pound of Modifolan. There's nothing else like Modifolan. It is the richest in alginate, phocoidin, organic iodine, and lamarian. Alginates are the most effective organic element in nature that enable the body to rid itself of heavy metals, radioactive elements, and toxins. Phocoidin is an extremely effective anti-cancer substance found abundantly in brown seaweed. Organic iodine is the greatest protection for the thyroid offered by nature. Laminarin aids in the prevention and treatment of cardiovascular disease. Go to www.mytrueessence.net and click the Modifolan banner to get started on your path to rich health today. Also, check out the Healing Shop for proven essential oils, medicinal teas, and even health coaching. It's time to get real and heal. Go to www.mytrueessence.net.
Get real and heal. Listen to Christie on Soul Journeys Radio.
Welcome to the world's meeting place. American.
It's practically narcotic.
Freedom.
Oh, yes. I like very much.
Radio.
You're an American institution.
American. American Freedom Radio.
So who am I? What the heck are we doing here? Who and what is God? And we are discussing that here tonight with Guy Steven Needler. GuyStevenNeedler.com is the website where you can find out where or how to get his books, The History of God, the Beyond the Source, book 1 and 2, and the ones he's working on right now. There are also some events he has going on. We'll talk about that in the last segment here. Your lectures and workshops and all of the fun stuff, as well as your personal healings and readings. But let's see, we left off. We were just going to talk about, that's right, the backfill people. Mm. What are the backfill people?
Well, just before we do that, I want to answer a question from Noliman. He says, maybe God does judge through its delicate parts. We judge ourselves and feel like hell at times. God doesn't judge us as such. But we do, and we are capable of judging ourselves. So yes. Sometimes we do feel like hell.
Yes.
Clearly we do. We're dissatisfied with what we are. But we should be kind to ourselves in knowing that whatever we do with the best of our ability at that point in time with the tools we've got available to us. And therefore, although we may judge ourselves, that inherently is our ability to allow God to experience that which we judge in ourselves, and therefore God may judge ourselves, but he doesn't do it per se. So we have to be kind to ourselves and not judge ourselves too harshly, because actually we're doing the best we can with what we've got. It's a bit like trying to change the wheel in our car with a knife and fork.
Yeah.
But okay, so that's a good question. Thank you for that. Now, it's backfill people, right? One of the things I understood very recently is about the ascension process, and I've written a number of articles on this, and that is that when we ascend singularly and collectively. Now, ascension is an individual process based upon our ability to work with our karmic cycle, our ability to evolve through our experience and learning, and how we move forwards with that rather than having to do it all over again. So when we move through the frequencies as a result of our personal ascension, we start to move out of those frequencies associated with the base frequencies of incarnate mankind. Now, the Earth and the local galaxy and a lot of the universe is represented on all of the frequencies associated with the physical universe, i.e. those frequencies that are used to construct it. But as an incarnate entity, we are not. As an energetic entity, we can work within it. But our incarnate self doesn't do that. So we're only able to visualize or see or work with the first couple of frequencies, first three frequencies, for instance. So as we move up the frequencies, we start to move out of the visual range or perceptual range of those individuals, or even frequential range of those individuals who aren't moving up with us. So we start to lose friends and family and people that we associate with over the years because they haven't kept up with us. This is through natural attrition. We see it as people don't keep in contact with us, they lose contact with us. We may move out of the area that they're in terms of our physical location. But what happens is that there are a number of individuals who are moving up frequentially as a result of their association with higher frequency pastimes or higher frequency individuals. And so we ascend individually and in a group way through something called triangulation, where we ascend through association with the other individuals of a higher frequency. But what this means is that there are a number of individuals who are left behind. Now, they're not left behind per se. They are still evolving, but at a slower rate than us. But yeah, there needs to be a critical mass of individuals within the frequencies associated with that they're working with to allow them to continue to work with those frequencies. And so what's being allowed now is a set of energetic entities of a lower frequency than ourselves when we're energetic, a lower grade, if you want to call it that, are being allowed to incarnate for the first time to maintain this this critical mass of individuals at the lower frequency, so that those individuals of the energetic genre of mankind are still allowed to be incarnate on Earth at their frequency and progress in their own right. So these backfill individuals are not of the same energy set as energetic mankind is. They're a different energy set totally. And you can tell them a mile away. They are totally engrossed in the physical. They are arrogant, they're aggressive, they have no coordination in terms of being able to relate to people who are higher frequency. They are only in it for themselves. And these individuals, they're doing us a favor. They're doing energetic mankind a favor because they're providing the absolute critical mass for the rest of those who are still progressing to progress. And so these backfill people are there to allow the lower frequency environment to exist whilst energetic mankind is ascending gradually to the point where they move out of the frequency that's associated with where they are right now. And then when that happens, the backfill people that are incarnate will no longer incarnate and they'll go back to their normal energetic state. But they will have gathered some of their own evolutionary content as well, and that will be passed on to their own genre of energy, and they will benefit as well from that point of view. But what that means is that because they've been working with us as a backfill, as to maintain this critical mass, so that those who are slower in ascending, slower in evolving with their physical body than everybody else, catches up with us. Then they can then those people who are left who are slower can catch up with us, and therefore they will start to become more, in keeping with energies. Well, what that means is that from their perspective, we will have disappeared. But then when they've worked upon evolving, we will start to reappear in their lives because they've caught up with us energetically. From our perspective, because we're at a higher frequency, we can see down the frequencies and see them all the time. But they will not see us because they're at a higher frequency. Now, let me give you an example of this. And it's a very good example. And I love giving this example. Have you ever been in a shop where you've bought something and you've gone to the cash register and you've been the first person there of two or three people? And the registrar has completely ignored you. And served the other people instead of you.
Yeah.
And that's because they don't see you.
Restaurants, absolutely.
You're a higher frequency. They don't see you with their physical eyes and they don't perceive you with their spiritual eyes. Because you're a different frequency. You're a different energy set to what they are right now. It's only when you get annoyed at them and you get frustrated that you bring your frequencies down to their level. And then they say, oh, sorry, ma'am, I didn't see you there.
That's true. Wow, that makes sense.
They didn't see you. You weren't there because you were a higher frequency. And what was happening is they were working with people of their frequency, not of a higher frequency. And they may even have been working with people who are incarnate backfill people as well. So we have to be tolerant of these individuals who are still working in the lower frequencies because we're working at a higher frequency. We don't know generally that they're working at a lower frequency unless we are in tune with that which they are, really. Some of us can spot them a mile away, others can't because they're not bothered about it. And so we have to be able to work with the lower frequencies and the higher frequencies. That's part of being grounded. We are here to do a job. We're here to experience, learn, evolve in a physical form whilst we're here. And that means we have to interact with those around us, irrespective of what frequency they are. And from the perspective of those who are ascending beyond those frequencies, we have to learn to be able to dip in and out of the lower frequencies whilst maintaining our frequency.
Okay. Wow. I'm actually grasping that a lot more than I thought I would, but I'm just going to kind of play devil's advocate here for a moment, and we do have a caller on the line, so we'll get to that. But as far as you mentioned when they catch up with us and stuff, I mean, isn't time itself an illusion, and is our process of evolution or ascension, I mean, there really isn't a race, is there? It's, don't we all just kind of evolve at our own time and our own path?
We all evolve at our own pace. There's no such thing as time. Time is a metric that mankind's existed, that mankind has invented for something that doesn't exist. But getting back to this evolution bit, we evolve in our own pace, in our own time, in our own way. There is no race. There is no criteria as to what we need to do. It's individual. We do it how we want to do it. Simple as that.
Okay. All right. So let's, I'm seeing we're going to have a break here in just a moment. So let's get to our caller. Here we go. Looks like Russ. How you doing tonight?
Christine. Okay. I'm busy. I'm trying to multitask. I'm not doing as good a job as you, but anyway, I'm doing wonderful. Thank you.
Okay, well, what do you have for us tonight?
What is the heaven and hell, and what are the differences between angels and demons?
Thank you, Russ. It's a fantastic question. Well, heaven and hell is something that's man-made. Actually, heaven is where we normally are, and are right now, if you think about it. It's a way of explaining the high and low frequencies. It's a way that we can understand in this particular environment that we're in, which is a low-frequency environment. So heaven is where we normally exist within the energetic, and hell is the lower frequencies, which is where we are right now. So there's no religious context to it, other than it's been used as a way to explain it to the level of education that was available to us when that information came to us. Hundreds of years ago, thousands of years ago. In terms of the demons and angels, well, again, the angels themselves are basically what I would classify as being maintenance entities to maintain the integrity, the evolutionary integrity of the multiverse. Demons are lower frequency astral entities, which are thought forms or energy with levels of low level intelligence that are given form by ourselves through incorrect thought processes or thought projections that hang around and need to perpetuate their own energy through association with the host. And so, because they can't metabolize their own energy, they need to associate themselves with a weak individual who is open and looking for some form of, shall I say, augmentation of ability in the physical. So these entities will latch onto them, they'll take energy from them, and in payment for that, they'll give them feelings of power.
Okay, Russ, did you, anything else you wanted to add or follow up with that? Oh, okay, looks like we lost him. Alrighty then. we're going to be going to a break here in just a moment, but, wow, that totally makes sense, because sometimes I feel totally invisible. And you're right, they don't notice me until I start to feel irritated. Like, I don't even have to say anything at all. I don't have to, like, say, hey, jerk, why are you ignoring me or anything like that. I just feel it, and then all of a sudden I'm noticed. That's very interesting. Huh. Okay. Gosh, I did also want to, so many questions, so much to talk about, so little time. Even though time isn't real, but apparently it is when we're on radio, because we are going to get cut off here soon. But I know you talk about karma and the karmic cycle in your book. Granted, we are going to get cut off here for a break here any moment, but if you would, I'd like to hear about karma, karma as energy, and maybe even recovering lost frequencies that you discuss in your book in chapter 11. But yeah, I hear the music now, so hang on, everyone. We will be right back. Guy Needler here on SoulJourneysRadio.com.
It's time to get real and heal. MyTrueEssence.net would like to tell you about Modifolan Brown Seaweed Extract. It's composed of an elementally rich seaweed called laminaria. It takes 40 pounds of laminaria to make just 1 pound of Modifolan. There's nothing else like Modifolan. It is the richest in alginate, phycoidin, organic iodine, and lamarian. Alginates are the most effective organic element in nature that enable the body to rid itself of heavy metals, radioactive elements, and toxins. Phycoidin is an extremely effective anti-cancer substance found abundantly in brown seaweed. Organic iodine is the greatest protection for the thyroid offered by nature. Laminarin aids in the prevention and treatment of cardiovascular disease. Go to www.mytrueessence.net and click the Modifolan banner to get started on your path to rich health today. Also, check out the Healing Shop for proven essential oils, medicinal teas, and even health coaching. It's time to get real and heal. Go to www.mytrueessence.net.
Get real and heal. Listen to Christie on Soul Journeys Radio.
News and information you can trust. This is American Freedom Radio. Freedom, freedom. American Freedom Radio. Radio. American Freedom Radio.
Welcome back, and thanks for joining us here tonight. Last segment with our special guest, Reiki Master, healer, author, and yeah, all sorts of fun and wonderful things. Guy Stephen Needler, GuyStephenNeedler.com is the website, and Stephen is spelled with a V. That's GuyStephenNeedler.com. And yeah, since this is the last segment, Guy, if we'll just talk a little bit about karma and what you discovered and shared in your book, and then I'd like to reserve some time to talk about your healing sessions, what you do, and your upcoming lectures and events.
Great stuff. Well, karma, karma's not what we think it is. I mean, the popular theory of karma is that if we push Granny under the bus on the road in front of us, and then we succumb to a similar level of fate, then the karma is negated. It's that is not what karma is. Karma is all about how we interface with the lower frequencies of the multiverse. How we interface with the lower frequencies that are associated with the physical universe, because the physical universe are the lower frequencies of the multiverse. And really we're here to experience them, learn from them, evolve from them, but not get intoxicated by them, not get distracted by them, not get intertwined by them, we're entangled by them. And this level of intoxication, entanglement, and entwined is basically to do with, for instance, the desire to incarnate again, the right to experience being drunk, the right to experience under the influence of drugs, the right to experience having material things around us, the right to experience being in positions of power, the right to experience having the ability to coerce people. All of these things, and much more, are karma. It's all about how we work together, how we interface with each other, how we work with the environment, and how we recognize it for what it is, or not as the case may be. Because if we don't recognize it for what it is, we incur the ability to be attracted to and attach ourselves to lower frequency existence. And it's as simple as that. I've recently had a book, which is not in print yet, but the contract has been signed by myself and Ozark, that explains what karma is, and there's about 104 different explanations of karma and a few other things as well. And that should be out in March next year. It's called Avoiding Karma: A Guide to Assuring Personal Ascension, and the reader should read no more than 2 aspects of it per week with a view to try and integrate it into their life. Now if they can do that, if they can read the whole book and integrate it all into their life, they are gods.
Okay. All right. So remember that, you overachievers out there.
To be honest, if they can do one or two things and integrate it into their lives, it will make a massive difference to their ability to remove karmic content from themselves. Because karmic content is all about attracting or being attracted to lower frequencies. And that pulls us down. That stops us from evolving. You know?
Evolution is this book available? I'm sorry to interrupt, Guy, but is it available yet?
No, but I'm going to give you a little secret. Right now, it's on my website. If you go onto the website, www.guystephenneedler.com, as Christie explained previously, all one word, with the Stephen being a V, look on the right-hand side of the homepage and look down for the Avoiding Karma link. Click on that, it's all there. When the book is published, it'll go. It'll disappear for copyright reasons. So while you've got a chance, look at it, because all the 104 opportunities for avoiding karma are there.
Wait, so what do I click on now? I'm on your site, and then I clicked on books, avoiding karma.
I'm going to do the same thing as you there, Christy, so I can walk you through it.
Okay.
If you go on to...
Okay, so anyone else wants to do this with us, just go to guystephenneedler.com.
Okay, do that. And look on the right-hand side and scroll down and you will see... Let me just do that.
Categories, Avoiding Karma.
That's it. Click on the Avoiding Karma.
There we go. Yeah, you have excellent articles there. By the way, I wanted to... So I might as well do that now. Like believing in yourself, removing self-doubt, being present as a reflection of our true self, staying grounded. So all sorts of excellent blogs and information on the website. But, okay, so for the karma thing, we go on the right column under categories and click on Avoiding Karma.
Yeah.
I see it.
And in the, I think it's in the youngest first, yeah, there we go. May 29, 2013. That's the last one I published because then the book was submitted to Ozark.
Okay, so you're saying these will be available on your website until the book is released.
Correct.
All right, so you better check it out soon, everyone. Okay.
It's there. And there's other aspects as well. But these items there are going to be the main content. It's only a small book. It's the main content of the book. And it's all about giving you the opportunity to work with something that will reduce and avoid your karmic content. And it's, you know, each one is hard work, its own right. And, don't worry about whether or not you can manage it. Clearly, the average incarnate individual cannot manage all 104 in...
You know what, honey? I'm so sorry. I'm looking at the clock, and I realize we're going to get cut off in the next 4 minutes, so we're just going to have to save the karma talk for another show, or you're going to have to go to the website and buy the book and all of that. So I apologize, everyone, but time is of the essence here tonight. So I did want to talk to you about your healings and your readings and how you can help us for all over the world. Thankfully, for Skype, maybe Skype is God, and some of your upcoming events that our listeners may be able to join you at.
Yeah, I mean, sure. The readings and healings, if people go to the homepage and click on the readings and healings tab and then select either healing or readings, they can get in contact with me via email.
And are these long-distance Reiki healing sessions?
Oh, it's much more than Reiki. It's a combination of initially Reiki, but I've also used a lot of the Brennan healing science, and I've developed my own stuff as well, based upon my experiences over the last 15 years. So, so basically, you know, the healings aren't anything. They're based upon Brennan healing science, yes, but they're also based upon my own developments as well, which is good. The readings are based upon my ability to log into the source and your true energetic self. And I can get information from you that you won't get from a normal medium as a result of that. And again, the workshops are there. I mean, I've just come back from a US tour, about 3 weeks in the US, doing three or four tours there, three or four different locations there. There's more next year. There's others around the world as well. Right now, the latest one is going to be Slovenia. I'm working on some correspondence courses that people can do the level one and level two, traversing the frequencies workshops in their own homes, so that they can essentially be taught to do what I do and get in contact with the source and the entities on these different frequencies and different universes as represented on these different frequencies as well. And I've used a couple of guinea pigs, some small students of mine who or people who've done readings with me or met me, to validate these things. And the feedback's been phenomenal. Yeah, these people are doing exactly the same things as people in the workshops, you know. They're doing it on their own, using the audio and using the written word and the PDF files. And it's exactly the same as being in the workshop. It's incredible. Now, the psychic shield is there right now in both an audio and a PDF form. The PDF is just being validated for level one workshop, traversing the frequencies, and we're very quickly going to follow that up with an audio. And we're just about to kick off the final editing of the level two workshops. But the thing is, people are reading these things and they're experiencing things almost straight away. It's phenomenal. It's just as powerful as being in a workshop with me. It's amazing.
Okay. And what kind of readings? We probably have 45 seconds left or so. Your readings differ from others, psychics, mediums, tarot card readers, etc. So can you give us a brief overview?
It's time to get real and heal. MyTrueEssence.net would like to tell you about Modifolan Brown Seaweed Extract. It's composed of an elementally rich seaweed called laminaria. It takes 40 pounds of laminaria to make just 1 pound of Modifolan. There's nothing else like Modifolan. It is the richest in alginate, phocoidin, organic iodine, and lamarian. Alginates are the most effective organic element in nature that enable the body to rid itself of heavy metals, radioactive elements, and toxins. Phocoidin is an extremely effective anti-cancer substance found abundantly in brown seaweed. Organic iodine is the greatest protection for the thyroid offered by nature. Laminarin aids in the prevention and treatment of cardiovascular disease. Go to www.mytrueessence.net and click the Modifolan banner to get started on your path to rich health today. Also, check out the Healing Shop for proven essential oils, medicinal teas, and even health coaching. It's time to get real and heal. Go to www.mytrueessence.net.
Get real and heal. Listen to Christie on Soul Journeys Radio.
You're listening to the future of talk. American Freedom Radio. This is American Freedom Radio.